thanks everybody for inviting me to speak today. And I look forward to talking about some of the epic research that I think is relevant to these topics that we've been teed up today. And as I think as the attendees have heard, there have been a couple of references to the EPIC program, the CEC funding. But I'll get into that in a little bit more detail, and then I'll talk about some of our examples of our research that relate to this area or research that we funded. So for those who don't know, the Electric Program Investment Charge is a ratepayer-funded program, research program, funded by the ratepayers of the investor-owned utilities, so PG&E, SCE, and SDG&E. That money is shared among the IOUs and the CEC to fund research that will support the ratepayers in those territories. And as Gary mentioned previously, some of the research that they're working on that he talked about in his talk is EPIC funded. They're using some of their EPIC research funding to look at these issues, particularly those that are supporting innovations in the state for preventing wildfires and making the system harden. So the research covers a lot of different topics, a lot of different areas. From the CEC perspective, we're really looking at three kind of broad categories as driving our research initiatives. As you know, the state's priorities on decarbonization are very strong. And so we have multiple efforts that focus on removing our reliance on fossil fuels and improving the renewable generation that we would utilize to make our state greener. And I'll skip the middle one and go to resiliency. Resiliency, as you know, is very important. The wildfires of this year and of previous recent years have shown that having solutions that provide ratepayers with resiliency is critical and is needed sooner rather than later. And some of the other technologies talked about today will help in that arena as well. And then I would say across the board, we also have an emphasis on affordability and equity, in the sense that we really want to make these clean energy solutions available to the residents in low-income and disadvantaged communities. They're usually the last to get the opportunity to take advantage of newer technologies, and we're wanting to find ways to bring these newer technologies into those communities. They also will benefit the most from reduction in their energy use. And so that kind of theme goes across all of our research and is a critical emphasis. I would have to say that if I think about EPIC, our EPIC strategy on the technology level, I would say that we have efforts that look at integration across the board. So as in introduction, it was pointed out that my team works on the smart grid related. So we're very technology integration focused related to microgrids, energy storage, and kind of tools for aggregation of distributed energy resources. But we also have research areas that focus just on specific technology. So as was previously noted, there's a high demand for a diversity of energy storage technologies in the state. And so we have a very robust research program that focuses on diversifying the portfolio of technologies available to the state, and we generally focus on non-lithium ion technologies. And so integration research areas and technology focused areas. Here's kind of a layout of our portfolio over the last about 8 years. We are excited to have the CPUC renew this program just recently. The original program was set up for 10 years, and that's rapidly coming to a close at the end of this year. And so the PUC had a proceeding which just renewed the EPIC program for another 10 years. So we're very excited about that, and renewed our funding for the CEC for about $130 million a year. And as you can see, we distribute that across a variety of different topic areas to help bring innovation to the state. And I would say that we've had quite a bit, as you can see, in the decarb and resiliency area, and even in multiple areas of decarb. We have more growing in the transportation electrification sector. And I think you'll find in the future that we'll be looking more at hydrogen that came up earlier in the conversation. And we see the necessity of expanding our analysis of where hydrogen can provide long-term storage or other solutions to the state, also in decarbonization. Here's just some numbers that we like to throw out to show the impact of the program. Since it's ratepayer funded, we like to show the ratepayers that we do provide value to them for this funded research. In the approximately $1 billion of funding that we have released over the last 8 years, the projects and the companies that were supporting that research have resulted in about $1.8 billion in additional funding, private investment after our research, which we think is a very strong sign that we're looking at technologies that have commercial viability, and those technologies are making their way into the market. And the other statistic that I want to point out is relative to one of my earlier slides is this desire to do more in low-income and disadvantaged communities. So 65% of our technology demonstrations are being conducted in low-income disadvantaged communities to really look at that nexus of where they can provide the greatest value in those communities. And we're going to continue to have a focus on that moving forward. It's just a very important part of our state goals to help those communities. Now what I'm going to do is go through some examples of research that's either been complete and funded or is in the process of the design and build out phase to show you some of the diversity of the technologies and the solutions that we have funded. So one of our most well-known and award-winning projects is the Blue Lake Rancheria, which was developed by the Schatz Energy Center at Humboldt State. At the Blue Lake Rancheria up in Humboldt area. This rancheria has a casino. That casino is a Red Cross shelter. They wanted to design the microgrid to be able to provide renewable backup and storage for that microgrid to support the community shelter in the event of an outage. There are many potential environmental challenges that can happen up in the Northeast, in the Northwest. Not only the wildfires, but also they're prone to potential for tsunamis. And so having backup power for the community was critical. As of last year, they had a great demonstration of this microgrid, which is up and running. And during the recent PSPS event up there, they were able to support about 10,000 of the local residents, either providing power at the community shelter, providing rooms at the hotel for those who have medical equipment where they need to have that operational while the grid is out. They have associated with this a gas station with a convenience mart that was able to provide food, ice, and fuel to those who needed it during those power outages. That was a multi-day outage up in Arcata and Eureka. So very phenomenal example of the value that a microgrid can provide and the integration that has to happen when you're combining large amounts of solar with storage, building loads, and distributing that and controlling that in a way that can provide the backup power. We've had a lot of conversation so far this morning about demand response. I think most people are familiar with Ohm Connect. They're one of our earlier funded projects. They've done very well in rolling this solution out. And in fact, during the most recent blackouts or potential blackouts that were occurring earlier this summer, they were able to go into operation and be able to save quite a bit of energy for the state to take the load off and make it easier for us to ride through those potential problems. We'll also note that OpenADR, which Scylla mentioned earlier, had some CEC funding, and she has been involved in driving a number of our demand response and what I consider kind of aggregation of DER solutions, bringing those to the market. So she's been, when she was at Stanford, did quite a bit for research in this area and made some really successful projects that were funded. Next one I want to talk about is one that's in the design phase, which is pretty interesting. We're very excited about it. So this is also the Schatz Energy Center up at Humboldt State. They took the lessons learned from the Blue Lake Rancheria and they combined forces with the Redwood Coast Energy Authority, who wanted to build a large solar array, a 2.2 megawatt solar array that they could provide and participate in the CAISO market. But they want to be able to use that for other purposes, including supporting the local airport, which is not only important for their accessibility, but also helps to support the Coast Guard and their emergency operations. So this is one of the first joint IOU end user microgrid. So the front end of the microgrid, the front of the meter portion, will be owned and operated by PG&E, and the behind the meter portion will be owned and operated by the Redwood Coast Energy Authority. And they'll be providing support to multiple customers during a grid outage. And so as part of that, they're looking at trying to create some creative tariffs that can be possibly a template for joint efforts between the utilities and CCAs in the future. This one is being watched very closely as part of the PUC's current proceeding related to microgrids and resilience, and the interest in having solutions that can provide multiple customers and deal with the challenges associated with multiple customers. As folks may or may not know, there are some challenges in the state legally and regulatorily around providing power to multiple customers, particularly if you're not a utility. You have to be a utility to do that. Either create your own utility or partner with an existing utility to make that happen. And so the regulatory and legal aspects of this make these challenging. This is one project that's getting past that. There are other projects that are struggling a bit because of the desire to create community microgrids and the ability to share power among different customers. This is one of those, the Lancaster Advanced Energy Community, which is really interesting in the sense that they're wanting to create a virtual power plant approach, which is connected multiple microgrids, whether it be municipal facilities or two zero net energy affording housing developments that are new construction, and looking to deploy different kinds of energy storage to each of the different communities to be able to evaluate the value of different kinds of energy storage, whether it's lithium ion or flywheel, to support those communities. So there'll be solar, new construction, meeting Title 24 requirements with solar, and also with aggregated energy storage. And so this is going to be a very interesting one that is really a big picture approach. And this is in collaboration with Lancaster Choice Energy. I want to briefly mention our vehicle grid integration projects. We have a number of projects in this area, and I won't go into detail, but I wanted to make sure we touched on it since there are others that mentioned vehicle grid integration, where we have projects that are not just looking at smart charging and controlling the charges in, say, parking garages or in fleets, but also looking at bidirectional charging and the opportunities and challenges associated with that, as well as the combination of different distributed energy resources, whether it's solar storage and vehicle charging combined, to see what the right nexus is, either at a residential sector or in a public transit forum. So we have a number of different projects here, and I just want to make sure I talked about that. And I didn't include a slide here, but I did want to mention that we have a large portfolio that we have funded just this year on energy storage, and that energy storage technologies are both developing new types of technologies that are non-lithium ion, as well as demonstrating long duration energy storage. And for this solicitation, the long duration energy storage is focused on at least 10 hours or more. And most of the, or a number of the recipients actually combined different types of non-lithium ion technology, whether it be flow or flywheel, or some just chose large flow batteries to produce this long duration storage. So we're very excited about these new projects, because I think that they're going to bring a great learning and capability building for advancing the duration that we can have on energy storage and providing greater resilience for the state. So what's next for EPIC? What's next is a lot of different types of research areas that we think are critical to the state. There's some on this slide that you can take a look at that are expanding upon our current portfolio. But I want to point out while I'm on this slide a couple of things, and that is with the current renewal of the EPIC program, we will be in the process next year of developing our next five-year investment plan. That plan will be developed with stakeholder input. And so we will be if you are interested in being engaged in the development of that research portfolio and interested in identifying and helping us craft the most critical priorities to focus on over the next 5 years, I recommend that you stay engaged, check on our website for the CEC's EPIC website, and we'll have information in there as we move into the early part of next year. So we'll probably be starting to announce stakeholder workshops in the January timeframe that will engage the public to get feedback on the research priorities for moving forward. So with that, I will wrap up.